Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to our next installment here of the Trader's Edge, a two-part installment, actually two segments. We're going to talk about the risk-return trade-off. And risk is a real important thing. Most traders, you know, they get into trading, they want to know, you know, I can make this amount of money, can I make this amount of money, can I get this return? But very few pay attention to the risks inherent in getting a particular return. So we have here an interesting slide, the galaxy of risk. It actually comes, it's adapted from Capital Markets Risk Advisors, who has been talking about the galaxy of risks for years. Very interesting outfit that talks about risk. And we have a few of them there. Volatility risk, interest rate risk, margin risk, credit risk, market risk, political risk. There's literally hundreds of risks out there. We're most interested as traders, though, in market risk, in volatility risk, and maybe some interest rate risk and some other things, but all those other risks there actually play into the markets on a daily basis in some cases. So we're going to talk about risk and reward, and it's a two-part series, so we're going to take it from a lot of different areas here, because risk, there's different layers of risk, different levels of risk, and this is just one area, the whole risk universe, so to speak, the galaxy of risks out there, and we're going to try to point them out to you. So risk and returns, like we said a few minutes ago, many investors, they get into trading with the hopes of making a significant return on their investment, yet they ignore the risks associated with those returns. So market risk and volatility risk being two that loom large, and that's in the galaxy of risks there. Those are the two things we watch closely as we're trading in the market going up and down. Those are the most impactful on a day-to-day basis. Risk management and risk awareness, it's paramount for the futures trader because of leverage and contract size. Some contracts are very, very large, and you also have this leverage. You put up a small amount and you control a larger amount of a commodity or a futures contract. The third point, many investors, small and large, they take enormous risks, yet their returns don't reflect that increased risk sometimes. I've seen two or three different type portfolio managers that take small amounts of risk and get really good returns, and I've seen other portfolio managers take large risk and not get as large a return as you would expect for that increased risk. The next point, greater risk should bring greater return. It's kind of related to the prior point, but not always. Successful traders know their risks in relation to returns and mitigate when necessary. And most importantly, the CME places so much emphasis on risk and risk mitigation that we built our house around it. And it's called the CME Clearinghouse, and it's what controls all the risks of all the positions that are held here at CME Group. So we change the margins, we set the margins, we do margins every night, we do, we raise margins depending on contract size, depending on volatility. So the clearinghouse is really into risk mitigation. So let's look here. Just one of the things when I'm talking to new traders, they ask, you know, what kind of returns can I expect? And I said, well, that depends on how much homework you want to do and how much experience you're willing to gain and how much homework you're going to do. So we have here, I have here a list. This comes from a great book called The Man Who Solved the Market, How Jim Simons Launched the Quant Revolution by Greg Zuckerman. And it shows some of the great investors of all time. Jim Simons, who ran the Renaissance Technologies, the Medallion Fund from 1980 to 2018, and he had 39% annualized returns, all right? George Soros got 32% annualized returns between 69 and 2000. Stephen Cohen of SAC between 92 and 2003 got 30% returns. Peter Lynch about 29% when he was running the Fidelity Magellan Fund from 77 to 1990. And of course, Warren Buffett, whose returns don't look as good as some of the other people's there at 21%, but he's done it for about 50 years. That's what sets him apart. It's one thing to have 10 or 20 years of really good returns, although that's very difficult to achieve. To do it for 50 years is quite incredible. And I urge you, we'll read it. Disclaimer down at the bottom, past performance is not necessarily indicative of futures results. No representations being made that any investor will or is likely to achieve the results that are on this table. Futures forward and options trading is speculative, involves substantial risk, and is not suitable for all investors. So be careful. This is what the best investors have gotten over time. Gauge your expectations accordingly. All right, so are you getting paid to take risk? Let's look at two traders. These are actual track records. I just don't have the names of the firms or the traders, but a trader one and trader two. Trader one at the top has 10-year annualized returns of 17.54%, all right? Now, standard deviation is a way to measure risk. Standard deviations, you know, can go, you know, they can be as low as 1 or 2 or 3%. They can be as high as 35, 50%, even 100% in some cases. So standard deviation of about 13.98 is about average, actually. The long-term returns of the U.S. stock market are right around about 14, 15% standard deviation. So 10-year annualized return, 17.54. The risk of trade run is measured by standard deviation of 13.98. His Sharpe ratio is 0.89. We'll get back to that in a second. Maximum drawdown, or in other words, how much money, the maximum you've lost in 1 month, 9.47%. And the maximum drawdown over the course of a year is 12.71%. So let's look at Trader 2 now before we get back to Sharpe ratio. 10-year annualized return is 18.01%. That's good. 17.54 and 18.01 are very good. They're very close together, if you'll notice. So Trader 2 gets a little bit greater return, but look at his risk. Look at the standard deviation of Trader 2, 31.22%. It's more than two times the risk is measured by standard deviation as Trader 1, yet he only gets about 46, 47 basis points better return. So he takes more than double the risk, but only gets a small incremental return on top of it. So is that good? Well, that's for you to determine. But if I see a trader, a portfolio manager, or myself taking twice the risk, and I'm only getting 46 basis points incremental return, to me, that's not worth the risk reward and return ratio there. So we go down to the Sharpe ratio for Trader 2 now, and you see the Sharpe ratio is 0.44. It's literally half of Trader 1. And the reason why is Trader 1 got a very good return, but he took substantially less risk. His standard deviation is less than one half of Trader 2. As a result, the Sharpe ratio penalizes that. Sharpe ratio just measures how are you getting paid? Are you getting paid to take more risk? We have the calculations on the following page, and you can get into them later as a homework assignment. But maximum drawdown for Trader 2 is 19.88% on a monthly basis, and on a yearly basis, 30%. So you can see, the standard deviation is greater for Trader 2. The maximum monthly drawdown is much greater. It's twice as much. And the maximum annual drawdown is, again, about 2.5 times as much. So Trader 2 takes appreciably more risk. So traders that don't like a lot of risk might not sleep as well with Trader 2, so to speak. There's the math behind it. The thing is Sharpe ratio and Sortino ratio, they're very similar. They take the performance of a portfolio, the return, and you subtract out the risk-free rate, which is usually treasury bills, U.S. treasury bills, 3 month or 6 month treasury bills, and you divide by the standard deviation. The rub against the Sharpe ratio, though, is it penalizes you for both downside and upside volatility. And a lot of people in the financial world say upside volatility is good. If you're making money as your portfolio is increasing and it's going up and volatility is going up, that's okay. You have a positive return. So they came up with an equation called the Sortino ratio. And it measures only downside volatility. So it takes the same components in the numerator, the return of a portfolio minus the risk-free return, and you divide by the downside standard deviation. And that gives you the Sortino ratio. So that about does it for risk in the part one here, risk reward. And I want to quote Howard Marks, who wrote, he's the author of The Most Important Thing. He's a well-known portfolio manager. He's done very well for his investors. And he says, controlling the risk in your portfolio is important and worthwhile. It's the investor's job to intelligently bear risk for profit. Doing it well is what separates the best from the rest. So good trading to all of you. And remember, always do your homework.